People around the world celebrate it by decorating their houses with red and pink hearts. It is on this day that the picture of the heart takes center stage. Millions of dollars are spent on heart candies, heart chocolates, and even heart-shaped cakes and pizzas. And billions of dollars are spent on heart jewelry. Why is this so? Because the heart is a universal symbol of love. Today, we'll find out that the heart is also the center of life and how important it is to take good care of our hearts. I am Pauline Baloyo, and join me in this Bible seminar with my parents, Rudy and Virgie. For 7 nights, let's all learn together how we can make our families healthy and happy for God's glory. Everyone, and welcome to the first episode of the Happy and Healthy Bible Seminar. Make sure to get everyone in your family circle tuned in to our program so you can also enjoy the benefits of having a healthy and happy family that God desires everyone to have. Jesus said, "I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." That is found in John 10:10. The Lord cares about our lives now. He wants the best for us now, not in the distant future, not a long way off. He wants us to enjoy life now so we can serve our families better. We can work and study better. God's desire for everyone is also stated in 3 John 2. Can we read it together? Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health. We will be listening to two sets of presentations tonight. The first one is about health. The information given in this series is for health education only, and it is not designed to be a substitute for the medical care of your physician. Tonight's topic is entitled 4 Steps to Prevent a Heart Attack. In its 2019 Global Health Estimates, the World Health Organization said that 120 out of every 100,000 Filipinos died of ischemic or coronary heart disease in 2019, the worst record among Southeast Asian countries that listed the ailment as its top cause of death. That's a big number of people dying of heart attack every year in this country alone. Heart disease is preventable, so get a pen and paper ready to take down notes on how to live a healthy and happy life free of heart problems. Mom, take it away.
Thanks, Pauline. We need to live a balanced life, and being healthy and happy, especially during this time of the pandemic, is just the right thing to do. Now, before I proceed, I'd like to tell you that the materials for this study and for this series is from this book, Healthy and Happy. And this is written by Gordon and Waveney Martin Barrow. Now let's proceed. How is your heart? Did you know that your heart is an incredible machine? The size of your heart is your fist, and it weighs just above 8 to 12 ounces. It starts to work 21 days after conception and continues non-stop throughout your life. The heart pumps the 5 liters of blood in the body non-stop. It pushes that life-giving blood throughout the more than 60,000 miles of blood vessels in just 1 minute. Isn't it amazing? When I think of this masterpiece, I can't help but exclaim, "I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made," as written in Psalm 139:14. The task of our heart is so important that if it fails to pump enough blood to deliver a continuous supply of oxygen and other nutrients to the brain and other vital parts or vital organs, we die. Now let us discuss the heart, the kinds of heart problems. So yes, for many people, this amazing machine malfunctions. In the last 20 years, heart disease, especially coronary heart disease or CAD, has remained the leading cause of death in the world and is still killing more people than ever before. This is according to the World Health Organization, or WHO. Now, coronary heart disease is caused by the buildup of deposits of fat in the arteries of the heart. These deposits are called plaque, and the buildup of plaque, also called atherosclerosis, causes the cardiac arteries to narrow, and therefore some parts of the oxygen are, or rather some parts of the heart are deprived of oxygen-rich blood. The affected blood vessels become weak and narrow and cannot function effectively. In worst cases, they block the passage of the blood, and this results in CAD. CAD decreases blood flow to your heart, decreasing the oxygen supply, and if left untreated, a complete blockage can cause heart attack. Now, let us be watchful of the following symptoms, and if ever you feel any of the following or even more, please don't hesitate to consult your physician. People having heart attacks can feel chest pain or angina, a shortness of breath, pain running down the arm or in the neck, jaw or back, profuse sweating, nausea or vomiting, or stomach pain, also dizziness, lightheadedness or fainting, and extreme fatigue. Heart attacks can't just be prevented by doing nothing. In order to prevent occurrence or recurrence of heart attacks, take note of these four steps. Okay, let's discuss them. Step one. To prevent heart attack, let's do aerobic exercises. The heart pumping aerobic exercise is the kind that doctors have in mind when they recommend that at least we should have 150 minutes per week of moderate activity. Just as exercise strengthens the muscles in our body, it helps your heart muscles become more efficient and better able to pump blood through your body. This means that the heart pushes out more blood with each beat, allowing it to beat slower according to rest, and keep your blood pressure under control, thus extending the life of your heart. What are some examples of aerobic exercises? Okay, walking, running, as you can see on the screen, cycling and swimming are great exercises to start with. Of course, for us seniors, walking is best recommended as it is the simplest, safest, and most inexpensive type of exercise. The recommended amount is, you know how many or how much? How long? 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. But if you have heart problems at the moment, it is better to consult with your physician on the right amount of exercise that is good for you and that your body can tolerate. Now, step two, eat a heart-healthy diet. Diet plays a major role in heart health and can impact your heart or your risk of heart disease. In fact, certain foods can influence blood pressure, triglycerides, cholesterol levels, and inflammation, all of which are risk factors for heart disease. A diet high in fiber and low in fat is recommended. Saturated fats, those that are found in red meat and dairy products, they raise the cholesterol levels and they increase the risk of coronary heart disease. So, let's avoid them. Let's avoid meat. A plant-based diet has zero cholesterol. So you eat an abundance of fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. Some research say that omega-3 improves heart health and lowers the blood pressure. Omega-3 is found in some fish like mackerel and salmon. For plant-based options, they are also found in flaxseed, most nuts, and soybeans. Now let's go to step number three to have a healthy heart. Step number three, if you smoke, stop smoking. Because nicotine harms the insides of blood vessels and reduces the amount of oxygen that the heart receives. It makes the heart beat faster and the damaged blood vessels work harder, thus shortening the life of the heart. Compared with non-smokers, people who smoke are more likely to have heart disease and suffer from a heart attack. We all know the health risks of smoking, but doesn't make it any easier to kick the habit. Now, let's go study these following tips that can help smokers quit smoking. Number one, make up your mind. The mind is powerful. Whatever it can conceive, it can achieve. Number two, stay away from triggers. A trigger is anything or anyone that encourages you to smoke. Now, number three, use distraction techniques. Do something or choose something or hold on to something to distract the desire. And number four, drink plenty of water. This helps to flush the poisons out of your body. Number five, if you can, join a support group because each can help the other. Quitting smoking is never easy, but it's going to be worth it. Now, the last step. Step number four, lower your stress. Oh, this lesson is good for me. Studies suggest that the high levels of cortisol from long-term stress can increase blood cholesterol, triglycerides, blood sugar, and blood pressure. These are common risk factors, of course, for heart disease. This stress can also cause changes that promote the buildup of plaque deposits in the arteries. A constant state of stress can cause heart attack. But you can lower your stress by relaxation exercises. This one I like. One of the best is deep breathing. Breathing from the diaphragm can lower your stress. Now let me teach you how to do diaphragmatic breathing. The first is to, of course, relax your shoulders and sit back, or you can lie down, and then place one hand on your belly and one on your chest. Now inhale through your nose for 2 seconds. And now you feel the air move into your abdomen and feeling your stomach move out. And lastly, breathe out for 2 seconds. Okay, I'll do it again. Through pursed lips while pressing on your abdomen. And then don't forget, if you can do this or add to this, do belly laugh. It can also help you cope with stress. So, laugh a lot. Healthy living is the best way to delay or avoid many heart and brain diseases. This means do aerobics, that's number one. Number two, eat heart healthy foods. Number three, stop smoking. And of course, try to lower the stress levels. Oh, I want to do these 4 steps. Will you do too?
Do you know that each of us has a spiritual heart? Your spiritual heart is your mind. It controls your spiritual life. But this spiritual heart, the mind, gets cluttered by plaque. And this plaque is called sin. I can think of 2 verses in the Bible that describe our condition and how we are born with such flaws. In Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, it says, "The human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is?" And in Psalms 51, verse 5, the psalmist said, "Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me." We are all born with spiritual disease. So how can I get rid of sin? Listen to these steps. First step, or step number one, experience God's forgiveness. After King David committed adultery with Bathsheba, he decided to cover up one sin with another and ordered the death of Uriah, her husband. King David was guilty of two counts, adultery and murder. Such grave sins need punishment. But how did David get rid of his terrible sins? He humbled himself and asked God for forgiveness. In Psalm 51, verses 1 and 2, his prayer was recorded after committing adultery with Bathsheba. He said, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." We have a God who can turn away from a humble heart asking for forgiveness. In fact, in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, it says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness." If you ask Him, God will forgive you too. And no matter how big or grave your sins are, He has already paid the penalty of sin when He died on the cross for you and me, as stated in John chapter 3, verse 16. "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life." If left to ourselves, we should have died for our sins. But Jesus died in our place. That's why we can be forgiven. His blood can cleanse my heart from every sin. Here is another fantastic text found in Micah chapter 7, verses 18 and 19. "Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity? He will again have compassion on us and will subdue our iniquities. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea." Now, let me tell you a story about Brother Amen. An excited believer liked to shout, "Amen!" It could be in church or wherever he is. But this annoyed some people. One day, Brother Amen got sick and visited his physician. The doctor thought of punishing this brother by handing him a dull geography book to read while he waited. But suddenly, the waiting room was electrified when shouts of "Amen! Amen!" "Whatever did you see in that book to shout Amen about?" asked the physician. "Well, doc," the brother replied, "it says here that the deepest part of the sea is in the Pacific Ocean. It is 36,201 feet, almost 7 miles deep. And God has promised to cast all my sins into the depths of the sea. That's 7 miles deep. Amen. Amen." Let's go to step number 2. Get a new heart like David did. The second part of David's prayer is found in Psalms chapter 10. It says, "Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." That's a spiritual heart transplant. And there is good news. Tonight, Dr. Jesus is ready to perform heart surgery. And it's free. The average cost of a heart transplant here in the Philippines is around 700,000 to 1 million pesos. That comes with a lot of risk like organ rejection and infections. But when we give Jesus our hearts, our spiritual hearts for that matter, He will give it to us for free. And only He can change the heart. But the preparation comes from man. God has promised us that if we come to Him with a faith that works through love and repent of all sin, He will be faithful to take out our heart of stone and replace it with a heart of flesh. He will write His laws upon our minds and hearts. Ezekiel 36:26 says, "I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. This heart surgery is called conversion. And when we are born again, God performs a heart transplant, as it were. He gave us a new heart, and the power of the Holy Spirit changes our hearts from sin-focused to God-focused. We do not become perfect. We still have our sinful flesh and the freedom to choose whether or not to obey it. However, when Jesus died for us on the cross, He broke the power of sin that controls us. So receiving Him as our Savior gives us access to God and His power, a power to transform our hearts from sin hardened to Christ softened. God's desire for every human being is that we become like His Son, Jesus. And we can become like Jesus only when we allow God to rid us of our old, hardened hearts and give us new hearts. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Conversion means a change of lifestyle, of our thoughts, words, and behavior. And this is great news. What God did for David, He is ready to do for you. He is the God of Almighty, of mighty miracles. It's a wonderful change. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. You know, it's an awesome change when the drunkard becomes sober. The drug user becomes an abstainer. The smoker becomes drug-free. The abuser becomes a caregiver. None of that will change if we will not give our hearts to God, because He is the only one who can change us with the help of the Holy Spirit. Wonderful news indeed. God is ready to change up your life and give you a new heart right now. So if you hear His voice, harden not your hearts. Whatever is keeping you from giving your heart to God, the time is now that you humble yourself before God and decide to take a stand in His side. My friends, this world is full of things that lure us from coming to know our Savior more because we still have a sinful heart. But in order for us to be transformed, we need Christ, who has the power to change us.
Thank you, Mom and Dad, for these reminders on how we can prevent heart attacks and how to have a new heart. Imagine a heart free of plaque and imagine our lives free from sin. We can only live a healthy and happy life when God is there. At this point, we'll be hearing a testimony. Let us hear how the Lord has transformed this person's life.
When I realized when the plane, you know, left, I was actually very upset. The reason why I visit here in the Philippines was actually to visit my family. When I saw my family, I was actually pretty excited, but at the same time, you know, didn't know what to expect because, you know, I haven't seen it for a long time. But at the same time, I heard a lot of good stories about, you know, my mother told me about how nice the Philippines was, and many, you know, stories. For example, the food, the dishes, and the many wonderful traditions and cultures that Philippines had. The most bizarre thing that happened to me in the Philippines was when I was at the airport. Because the reason being is when I was at the airport, I was really excited actually to go back to the States because there was many things I wanted to do. But not knowing when I got there, I noticed that my flight wasn't in the bulletin board, wasn't on there. So I was very, I guess, scared that I was not going to make my flight. Technically, I was supposed to be there at a certain time, but I didn't. When I realized when the plane, you know, left, I was actually very upset because I was, I'm very time oriented, so I really wanted to be on time. But because of the fact that I didn't make it on time, I was very upset, disappointed, and also very stressed out and worried that what I'm going to do next, because now that I missed my flight. So the first thing I did was I went to the security guard and asked him, where's my flight? Here's my itinerary. Here's my passport. Where do I go? And he says, well, you have to go upstairs. And I was like, really? I was very surprised. So I had a basic hassle going to the immigration, not knowing that because I missed my flight, I had to basically rebook again, which cost me a lot and was very expensive. I didn't know what to expect afterwards, because I was thinking in my mind, I had to hassle with basically immigration, all that stuff, which was a time consuming. I remember Lillian picked me up and she was pretty surprised. So basically when she picked me up along with her church friends, it was very actually heartfelt, very loving, and very happy, you know, because the people I was with, I did not realize till afterwards that those were the people that will help me spiritually, guide me in my life as far as, you know, how to, you know, really put God into my life. One of the things that really, I guess, captured me was the fact that everybody at the church was very welcoming and very, I guess, they accepted you for who you are. Even though I was still interested in everything that I saw, there's still many questions I had. And there's this one person, one of Lillian's friends, that he actually really helped me be convinced. So when we got from Genesis to Revelation, everything kind of correlates, which basically means matched up with each other. It was like, oh wait, what I was looking for was right here. The other denominations that I've encountered, the Jesus that they inscripted for me wasn't the way Seventh-day Adventists inscripted Jesus, you know, in their eyes. And the Jesus they inscripted is actually through the Word of God. My message to all those viewers all across this country and this back home, sometimes what you think could be the worst thing in your whole wide world is something God will turn into your biggest blessing of your life. Don't think that what you experience now will be your worst nightmare, because what God has in store for you will be your greatest blessing.
Testimony indeed, when Christ works in our lives. Having a changed heart begins with recognizing that our hearts need to be changed. But while it's easy to recognize that our heart needs changing and to want it to be changed, our limited human nature makes it difficult for us to change our own heart. Only God can really change hearts. Without God working in us from the inside, there is little hope to have a truly changed heart, but God can ever make our hearts pure for the glory of His name. Thank you for joining us today, and see you again in our next episode tomorrow, and learn how we can combat stress with 6 things that you can actually do. Please don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at Adventist Asia. Thank you everyone for joining us today. I am Pauline Baloyo, and this is Healthy and Happy Bible Seminar. Stay healthy and happy for a blessed life here and for eternity. Have a good day.